Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. I apologize for the slight delay in starting, but anyone who's been to Berkeley knows that Berkeley time is 10 to 12 minutes after the scheduled moment. My name is Jack Citrin. I'm a professor of political science at Berkeley and also the director of the Institute of Governmental Studies, which is hosting this event. And I really want to thank all of you for coming to this conference, Election 2016, California and the Country. Just a word about the Institute of Governmental Studies, or IGS. It's UC, it's the University of California's oldest public policy research center. It was founded in 1919 on the optimistic, some might say Pollyannish premise that academics could say something that would help improve the quality of government. Thankfully, our funding is not dependent upon fulfilling that promise. But we have, from the very beginning, shed light, or attempted to shed light, on our nation's and the state of California's pressing issues through research, through education, and through public outreach. Today, we turn our attention to one of the most unusual elections in American history and to what comes next in governance in Washington. This is the Institute's first event in our capital, and it comes at a historic moment as people, academics, and others are questioning the capacity of our longstanding institutions to meet the challenges confronting the country in an increasingly turbulent world. We are, of course, only a little ways from the Lincoln Memorial, and I'm reminded of Lincoln's statement that a house divided against itself cannot stand. Today, our three panels will provide insight both into where we stand and to where we might be going. And so before we turn to the panels, I would like to introduce Bill Brandt, the chair of the Institute's National Advisory Council and someone who has urged us throughout to increase our presence in Washington. But before introducing Bill, let me thank some of the people who have made this event possible. First of all, our sponsors, KP Public Affairs and Remco Johansson and Purcell, they've provided critical financial support for us. The Washington chapter of the Cal Alumni Association provided assistance in outreach, and I want to recognize all of the Berkeley alums who are here today, and some of them even took classes from me. We want to thank the California State Society for reaching out to its members, many of whom also are here today. And finally, of course, to thank in advance our terrific panelists. You can read more about them in the program. Many are already well known to you, but I'm especially grateful that all of them took time from their busy schedules to be here today and to make this event successful. Now let me introduce Bill Brandt, the chair of the IGS National Advisory Committee. Bill has a record of success in both business and public service. He's been in the business of workout, turnaround, and insolvency consulting for more than 30 years, and he's the president and CEO of Development Specialists Incorporated. He also served two terms as chair of the Illinois Finance Authority, one of the nation's largest self-finance entities engaged in issuing bonds, making loans, and investing capital. But aside from all of these activities, Bill has been a tremendous supporter of the Institute of Governmental Studies, and he's played a critical role in all of our activities, including this effort to bring IGS programming to Washington. So, Bill.
Thank you, Jack, and thank you all for coming today. As Jack said, this is an effort to bring new programming from IGS to Washington. I have had the privilege of serving on the board for 10 years now with some of the finest people I can imagine working with me in California, and we've often talked about the fact, given the Cal graduates that are all across the country, that we should focus more of programs on Washington, and this is the first of a number we intend to do. I'm glad we're holding this event here today. I'm hoping in the future we'll have many more to happen. And I invite your participation. You know, the panel today is going to be great on this topic. I'm still recovering. Earlier this month, a cataclysmic event rocked the country. There are only a handful of people alive who have remembered the last time this occurred, but enough about the Cubs. So, waiting as I have since the late 1940s for the Cubs to win the pennant in the World Series, I assumed I was going to be treated to two lovely months of post World Series headlines and all kinds of, and the hot stove leave, and it was wonderful. And then 6 days later, a presidential election happened that I quite hadn't counted on. Full disclosure, I'm an elector in the Electoral College. I will cast my vote in Illinois on December 19th for the loser. Notwithstanding that, and notwithstanding the fact that in 6 days the Cubs won the World Series and Trump won the presidency, and for those of you who obviously have end of days thoughts, it could be possible with those two events. I probably had 20 minutes of remorse as the election results came in. I am, unlike Mike Pence, I am secondly a Democrat, I am first an American. And I thought to myself as the events rolled through the night that this was an amazing demonstration of the vitality and the vibrancy of American democracy. I didn't particularly like the outcome for my candidate, but in the greatest human political experiment the globe has ever seen, we have added, if you will, a new wrinkle. It is like the chemistry teacher in high school who told us, here's a beaker, it's been stable for a long time, occasionally it has small reactions, but we've learned to manage it. I'm about to put into it through a test tube a rather involved new catalyst. And while it starts fizzing and overrunning its beaker, I'd like you all to figure out why the catalyst did this, how we bring back stability, and what this means for the future, either on a molecular level or, if it has to be, down to the level of the atoms. That's what we're doing here today. Many of us, I think, saw this particular campaign as an outlier. Using Chairman Mayo's phrase, it might have been a great leap forward, or depending on your persuasion, a great leap backward. Either way, we have to begin the process, I believe, of routinizing this process and this election and bringing it back into the mainstream of American thought and analyzing it. And that is the purpose today of this particular program. It is important that the largest and most prestigious university in the largest state in the union reach out to Washington and begin to do these programs. And so I am happy we do these programs. I'm even happier the Chicago Cubs are the 2016 world champions, but I'll get back to that later. A few of you want to join me at the bar at the end of this event. I'll be buying rounds on behalf of Bryant and Rizzo. But for now, let me thank you all for attending. Let me get on with the program, and I'd like to turn it over to the moderator of our first panel, Carolyn Lochhead of the San Francisco Chronicle. Carolyn, thank you all.
You know, I'm the Washington correspondent for the Chronicle, also a Berkeley alum. And what we're going to do today is we're going to have each of our esteemed panelists talk for 7 to 10 minutes. And then I'll be asking questions, and then we'll have questions from the audience. And they each have stellar biographies in your program, but I want to quickly introduce Jim Brulte, who's the chairman of the California Republican Party, whose demise has been rumored for many years now.
You mean mine or the party?
And then Thad Kousser, who is chair of the political science department at UC San Diego, author of many books. He specializes as a scholar of the role of states and governors in the American political system. Carla Marinucci, one of the top political writers in the state of California, has been for a long time. She's the Bureau Chief of Politico for California, and does a must-read piece every day for California politics. Finally, we have John Perez, former Speaker of the Assembly in California, now is a regent of the University of California, and helped Democrats become a supermajority in the chamber under his watch. So I thought we could start with Thad. What do you have to say about this election?
All right. Well, thanks very much. Thanks for everyone for coming.
For the past couple of weeks, my fellow citizens in the Progressive Republic of California have been having a hard time, been doing a lot of crying in our lattes, driving around self-driving aimlessly in our Teslas, contemplating secession from the Union through Cal exit, and most of all, looking for a silver lining in the cloud for California progressives of this election. And I think the consolation for many Californians is that we've been here before. We've been almost exactly in the same place in our political past that the nation is in its political present. California has seen a shocking election with an underdog candidate coming to power because he embraced a strong stand against illegal immigration that resonated with many white Democrats and helped him to defeat an experienced politician, a female politician from a big political family. And that year, of course, is 1994. Pete Wilson is playing the role of Donald Trump. Kathleen Brown is playing Hillary Clinton. And the reason that for many Democrats in California, this is a silver lining is because we all know how this prequel to the 2016 election ended in California, right? So it was a short-term victory for the Republican Party in California that sowed the seeds for its long-term political challenges. And the idea is that what we've seen in California's present is a prediction of the nation's political future. If this is a case study of the theory that demographics is destiny in politics. So under this theory, California's the demographics, especially when those demographics are, the demographic characteristics are heightened by sharp campaign rhetoric that's perceived as anti-immigrant, that's gonna lead to a long-term reaction, a counter-reaction that's gonna be more powerful than the short-term political gains. And that's what's moved California from a purple to a light blue to now a deep, deep blue state. The idea is that the nation's future demographics, as the nation becomes more diverse and cosmopolitan, it will inexorably follow the path of California towards the democratic light. Right? So what I want to start off by doing is by examining this conventional wisdom, by telling the story of Prop 187, 1994, so we can start with a factual basis, and then poking some holes in it and thinking about some reasons why that future, that California's present may not be the nation's future, that there are other paths that California politics could have taken and that the nation still could take, then we are not destined to be a democratic state, no matter how much the demographics may point in that direction. So here's the conventional wisdom story. So let's go back to the early 1990s. California's demographics look a lot like the nation's do today. It's a strongly white majority electorate, very strong, between 70 and 80%, depending on the election, of the electorate is white, even though there are many minority groups that are in the population, but not well represented in the electorate. So African Americans are the most solid voting bloc, consistently turning out, solidly Democratic, but not big enough to be pivotal. Latinos are loom large in the population, but not in the electorate. So in 1990, Latinos were 26% of California's population, but only 15% of eligible voters, 10% of registered voters, and 6% of the people who actually turned out at elections. So this is not big enough to swing elections yet. Asian American population rapidly growing, but also very small in the electorate. So the elections were still about who could do the best with white voters. And so Pete Wilson, when he was due to basically the economic circumstances of the state and we had the recession of the early 90s, his approval ratings are very low. He latches onto, he didn't propose, but he latches onto Proposition 187, the Save Our State initiative that said illegal immigrants couldn't have access to health, non-emergency health care, social services, and education, right? So to many people, this was a reasonable proposal at the time, even though it's now anathema in California politics. 36% of Democrats voted for Prop 187. And 19% of Democrats liked it so much that they crossed over and voted for Pete Wilson rather than Kathleen Brown. Right? So you have immigration in the short term, this tough anti-immigrant stance, this Trumpian stance of Pete Wilson in 1994, leading to a big comeback political victory. And for other reasons, Jim Brulte also led his California Assembly Republicans to capture a majority for the first time in how many years was that? You know, since the 50s, I believe, right? So California turns right with the rest of the nation in 1994. But we've moved in a very different direction since then. And why is that? Well, Prop 187, you know, awakened the Latino voters and mobilized in a way that, that we hadn't seen before in American politics. So one change was that a huge number of new citizens go through the naturalization process, partly because they're motivated to get involved in politics and to protect their rights. So you see the number of naturalized citizens moving from 178,000 in the 2 years before that election to 515,000 in the 2 years after that election. Now, most new citizens actually don't turn out at very high rates. So in the early 90s, it was like 43%. But this group of new voters in the 1996 election, many of them, most of them Latino, turn out at a very high rate in the high 60s. Right? So they're more voters, they're more mobilized, and they're much more strongly Democratic than before. This marks the Republican Party as the party of anti-immigration. Latinos go from kind of an up-for-grab voting block that went 52 to 40 for Bill Clinton in 1992, and they go like 72 to 21 for Bill Clinton in 1996. And in most elections since then, it's been about 75-25 for Democrats capturing the Latino vote in California. So you have this rising demographic that by 2010, which is this watershed election, right, in California, 2010, Latinos are 22% of the electorate according to exit polls. Right, so now this is a decisive coalition and a huge part of the Democratic caucus in the legislature and delivering a lot of victories on access to high, we go from Prop 187 to a time when Dreamers have financial aid and an in-state tuition in the UCs, driver's licenses. A lot of, you know, big change in the local school funding formula that has benefited English language learning schools. So this has been both a political and a policy change in California that has solidified kind of the Democrats as the party of Latinos, the party of other minority groups in California, and as the state gets more and more diverse, it's very hard for Republicans to win at the statewide level. We have the great exception of Arnold Schwarzenegger, but every other statewide office holder in California at that time was a Democrat. And in the last few elections, right, we have Jerry Brown winning a re-election without running any political ads. We have two Democrats making it through to the top two of the Senate in the last Senate race, and California is, for all intents and purposes, a one-party state. Supermajorities in both houses of the legislature. So is the nation headed in that direction? Well, I think there are three caveats. There are three things that happen in California that may not happen in the nation, right? And one is that Democrats, white voters are still a majority of the California electorate, Democrats have run up big wins with every minority group in California and really strengthened that by delivering tangible policies, right? So look at Hillary Clinton. She runs 5 points behind Barack Obama with African Americans, I think 7 with Latinos, and 8 percentage points behind him with Asian Americans. So she still won all those groups, but she didn't rack up the big wins with Latino groups. Now, maybe that's because you need a person of color at the top of the ticket. That could be the lesson from Barack Obama. I think the lesson from California is you don't, right? We've had Gray Davis. We've had Arnold Schwarzenegger. We've had Jerry Brown. Right? There we go. Gray and brown, very good. But not a whole lot of color there. And if you look right now at the top four polling gubernatorial candidates, you got three white guys and Ashley Swearingen, a white woman. So it's not as if California at the top of the ticket, at least in the governor's races, has become just the domain of Barack Obama-like candidates. But we've had Democrats who have delivered tangible policies. And there's a question about whether the Democratic Party can credibly promise that at the national level and deliver it when the Democratic Party is in power. A lot of debate over whether Barack Obama, for all the success of DACA, was really great on immigration. So another thing that needs to happen is that Democrats need to stop the bleeding among white voters and keep some semblance of support among white voters. So when everyone was talking about 2012 and how well Barack Obama did and how demographics was going to be destiny, people didn't talk a lot about the fact that with 39% of the white vote, he did worse among white voters than any Democrat since Michael Dukakis. Now, we thought that put kind of a floor on how well you might do with white voters and that Hillary Clinton would succeed that, but she was down at 37%. And so Democrats need to find some way. They can't just be the party of the new groups and the diversifying electorate. They need to find some way to hang on in the way that folks like Gray Davis did well in the Central Valley of California and the Inland Empire, which are kind of our Ohio and Pennsylvania, right? These are the heartland areas that feel just as resentful of the coastal elites in LA and the Bay Area as people in Ohio feel about people in New York and California. So you got to find candidates like that who can have that kind of crossover appeal. And then finally, the third caveat is, well, demographics may be destiny for politics, but politics also affects demographics, right? And policy decisions affect the future look, shape of the American electorate. So this year, in the 9 months leading up to this election, we had something like 718,000 new applicants for citizenship in the United States. And this was the most in any election year since 1996. But the question is, will their applications be processed very quickly? Bill Clinton, as president, recognizing this issue, put a lot of resources into processing and naturalizing citizens. He allowed that big bump between 94 and 96. Will a Trump administration be as energetic in that? Probably not, right? So I think there are a lot of reasons. There are many reasons to be hopeful if you're on the Democratic side for the lessons that California has for the nation, but there are a lot of reasons to be cautious about thinking that absent good candidates and absent good political strategies, the demographics equals destiny. Thanks.
Great, thank you, Carla. That was a great overview, academic overview, and I appreciate that. I'm just going to give you the view from the ground, from the way we see it from the press corps in California. At the last count, Hillary Clinton is ahead of Donald Trump by around 3.9 million votes from California. Trump this week, of course, made a lot of news challenging that on Twitter, saying that there were millions of fraudulent votes in California. Of course, there's no evidence of that. But I've got to say that there was a time when Donald Trump courted California, loved California, understood the value of having a strong showing in California. And that was during his 1999 run for president, which some of you may not remember, but he did run for president as a Reform Party candidate. He came to California, and I traveled with him then. He brought his Trump One plane. He brought Melania, his then girlfriend. He showed sort of a glimpse of what we saw today. And I don't know, I got it all wrong, as many of us did. Because after watching him in 1999, I thought there's just no way this is going to really happen. It was an unconventional campaign back then. He did things like take us to hang out with Jay Leno in the green room on The Tonight Show, his buddy, go to visit Anthony Robbins, his friend, the motivational speaker. In the middle of the campaign, he dumped the Reform Party. He just said he didn't really like that platform. He was selling a book at the time. We spent a lot of time with him on the Trump One plane, which at the time had a round bed, that I remember, and gold fixtures. At the end of the campaign, he sent me a note on a letter on Trump stationery, which I haven't gotten a letter like this ever since I've been covering politics. And it just showed how much Donald Trump, I think, wants to be liked by the media. It basically said, "Dear Carla, thank you very much for the fair and balanced story that you did." The last sentence of the letter says, "You can interview me anytime you want." And in writing, he wrote, "Even if you don't want to." So I was like, okay. I've since framed that and tweeted it and said, I hope he keeps to that promise. But, you know, we've seen this movie before in California, and Arnold Schwarzenegger, you mentioned that, is another example. Arnold came to power using almost a similar phrase to make America great again, sweep Sacramento clean. He had the same sort of angry, throw the bums out theme. He was a guy, a lot of us, we were there at The Tonight Show the night that he announced for governor. We were all backstage going, no way, just as I said with Trump, too many women, too many lawsuits, ain't gonna happen, this guy's not gonna run. That he announced, and within 90 days, he was heading what was then the eighth largest economy in the world, today now the fifth largest economy in the world. I remember standing at the side of the stage the day that Arnold Schwarzenegger was elected, and he was going up to the stage, and he came over to us in the press, and he said, He just looked at us, and as the applause was going and he was about to take the stage, he said, "Only in America." And, you know, that's kind of true for Donald Trump as well, I think. Only in America. And the question is, how did we miss it with Donald Trump? A lot of, I think, what we missed is right in our home state of Silicon Valley, of California, that Silicon Valley. The engine of the innovation economy, the place where the entire world is watching the developments that go on there, with our office in San Francisco is within a stone's throw of Twitter, Facebook, et cetera, Google. All these companies have had such a huge impact on the American workforce. And I think what Donald Trump tapped into was that the angst about some of the changes that this technology is creating all over the country. When you have folks in Silicon Valley today talking about, isn't it great, we're developing driverless cars. We have Google, all of these companies are now looking into the technology without sort of acknowledging that there are 2 million long-haul trucker jobs that there, as Am Malik today in The New Yorker had a great piece on this. There is no empathy in Silicon Valley, that folks aren't looking up from their iPhones long enough to understand that out there in Ohio and other places, they're watching the changes that are being brought by Silicon Valley, and they're not understanding how it's affecting average folks. And I think Donald Trump tapped into that, tapped into the concerns about globalization, trade, such a huge issue in California. And these are some of the issues I think California's gonna now have to deal with, because we are our own nation state in a way. We've sort of declared now, a lot of our elected officials in California have already thrown down the gauntlet to Donald Trump, including our newly elected US Senator Kamala Harris, a woman of color. There's a change right there. On the issue of immigration, we're talking about huge numbers. First of all, California, home to the most undocumented immigrants in the country, more than 2 million. And the kind of monies, we're talking about federal funds. Los Angeles alone, $500 million at stake, potentially loss in federal funds. San Francisco, $1 billion. Oakland, $140 million. Its Mayor Libby Schaaf said this week, this is federal funding that goes to homeless shelters, meals for the elderly, low income. All of these cities have thrown down the gauntlet on this issue of sanctuary cities, of which there is no real definition. And we've heard one of our gubernatorial candidates, Gavin Newsom, declare his intention to try and establish, also a region at the University of California, to establish sanctuary campuses, a sanctuary state. Elected officials on the Democratic side all over the state, and we're talking cities that are the engine of this economy when you talk about San Jose, San Francisco, Los Angeles, provide a huge amount of drive to the American economy. So that is going to be, I think, something we all have to watch, is where California goes now in the Trump era, not only on immigration, on climate change. Carolyn, you just wrote about this. Our governor, Jerry Brown, has also effectively declared that California is going to be its own nation on the issue of climate change, going to go after continue to get more agreements with other nations and other communities around the world, and are not going to stop that drive. And on the issue of trade, Mexico is our number one export partner, and how this whole issue of NAFTA, and if Trump pulls back from that, I talked not long ago to former Secretary of State George Shultz at Hoover, who mentioned that, I think he's very concerned about this. The fact is that the United States is very fortunate to have two neighbors, of which we are both have tremendous relations right now. And he was instrumental in helping to put together NAFTA, which was eventually signed under Clinton. And he said, why would we want to undo that policy that has created so many jobs in the United States? That's, I think, that those issues are among the ones we're going to be looking at in California. And I think for that reason, the West Coast will be a place to watch as we see how this administration develops.
Thank you, Carla. Jim, would you like to say a few words? John?
Maybe after I'm done, Jim will. You've had two very different types of perspective, an academic perspective from Thad that I tend to agree with, and then a media on the ground perspective from Carla. I think what's missing is kind of the practical, hands-on perspective of folks who actually engage in some of this political fight, and that's why I think Jim may want to add to some of what I'm about to say. I think many of the thematics that both of you have talked about are meaningful. There are a couple of conclusions that I agree with, a couple that I don't. Let me first say that I absolutely agree with the conclusion that demography is not destiny. It absolutely is not. It gives people a false sense of both what has occurred and what is likely to occur. Similarly, the population patterns that Thad talked about in terms of shifts in population in California are very different than they are in the country as a whole. But here's what is meaningful. If you look at the places with the greatest increase, for example, of Latino immigrant population over the last decade, they've been places that you never thought of as being Latino centers of population, places in the Midwest, places in the Southeast. And so you have new sets of tensions and concerns that never were given voice before because there were never some of the on-the-ground, real-life challenges that people are dealing with. Do they play out exactly as they did in California before? No. But there is some instructive value of what that experience was. I think the 1994 analysis of the Pete Wilson election is broadly a good one to look at. One of the topics that didn't get discussed, which I think is really relevant, is not just the question of Prop 187 and immigration, but really the fact that at that point, California was dealing with an economic crisis in many ways similar to what other parts of the country are dealing with now. The recovery from a recession that was uneven, and the recovery from a recession where lower-skilled and medium-skilled workers who had good-quality jobs weren't finding those jobs in similar numbers in the recovery. So in California, the 90s and the recovery from that recession didn't bring back those medium-skilled jobs, and we lost huge numbers of manufacturing jobs in particular. So you saw workers very concerned about what their economic future looked like, not unlike what you've seen in other parts of the country this year. And in particular, in 1994, one of the reasons you saw a Democratic bleed wasn't just the question of immigration and Prop 187, but the reinforcement of another concern that existed, because in January 1st of 1994, you had the implementation of NAFTA. So you had an uneven recovery, a loss of jobs, and a concern for a new set of loss of jobs that were possible because of how NAFTA would be implemented. I actually think that is one of the more interesting parallels we should be looking at, because there is a huge question about the uneven nature of the recovery from the last recession and what that meant for economic angst for working people throughout the country. And the other parallel, I think, was interesting to look at Kathleen Brown versus Hillary Clinton. In both cases, yes, you had people with good traditional pedigrees, but in both cases, you had candidates who had a deficiency of being able to connect with the average voter that seemed overly stilted, that seemed disconnected from day-to-day real-world concerns. And I can quote back to you almost word for word Kathleen Brown's speech from her campaign for governor in 1994. I thought about it as you were saying. She said, "Isn't it time we have a Democratic governor in California? Isn't it time we have a woman governor in California? Isn't it time we once again had a governor named Brown in California? Well, I'm a Democrat and I'm a woman and I'm Kathleen Brown and I've got a plan for California, an 82-page plan, and elect me." There was no connection. There was a reinforcement of being from an established group of political elite. There was a reinforcement of an idea of identity-based politics that didn't necessarily appeal to the majority of voters. And there was an inability to connect organically. all of the things that Jerry Brown has in his unique way and Bill Clinton has in an extraordinary way were deficiencies of both of these candidates. But the other is the predictive value of economic growth and what that meant for the support of the party in power. And if you look back historically at shifts in White House control from one party to the other, and you overlay it with economic expansion in the preceding years, there's a huge predictive value. And that's something that none of us were talking about with respect to the presidential election. If you look at that, you won't be surprised in any meaningful way with the results. But the other shift that happened in California wasn't just a demographic shift. It was a shift in the way that Democrats engaged in politics. It was not looking at California as a monolithic state, but understanding that what had traditionally been a north-south state was increasingly politically an east-west state, and proximity to the coast had a greater predictive value than anything else in terms of how you would vote for a variety of reasons. And Democrats understood that we had to expand our bandwidth and that we had to be a bigger tent party and talked in broader ways that spoke to the economic and optimistic needs of everybody. Again, a distinction from the 2016 presidential election, where it was much more of a one from column A and one from column B, very specific messaging that didn't have broad-based resonance. Even when you look at the Arnold Schwarzenegger election, you cannot draw that conclusion. Arnold Schwarzenegger was not elected governor in a traditional election. It was a recall election where there were two separate questions. One, shall Gray Davis be retained? Two, if not, who shall replace him? If he had been through a traditional Republican primary, I don't believe he would have become the nominee and he wouldn't have been governor. Re-election, a slightly different question. But even as you look at the succeeding elections in California between 94 and 2016, let's even say 2012, when I helped lead us into the first supermajority since 1883 for Democrats in both houses of the legislature, it wasn't linear. You had significant setbacks. So in 94, you had Prop 187. In 98, when Democrats took back the governorship for the first time in 16 years, at the same time, you had the passage of Prop 227, which eliminated bilingual education, something that the voters have just reversed themselves on in the last election. And election cycle after election cycle, you had hot button issues that were, some would think, intended to turn out a certain mindset and turn a certain electorate, and it didn't always track. There was a degree of disjointedness, none more personal to me than 2008, my first election to the legislature, where my district voted for me to serve in the legislature, voted for Barack Obama to be president, but voted to ban me from being able to get married. This is not a linear, singular direction. It's nuanced, and voters vote in ways that are not expected. In this election, people look to the fact that California voted to legalize recreational marijuana. Well, they also voted to make it easier to enforce death penalty. They voted to reject the notion to throw out the death penalty and voted to approve a measure to make it easier to enforce the death penalty and go from conviction and sentencing to actual execution. So let's be very clear that it is not a singular direction, it is not monolithic. And so part of the distinction in California was a focus, especially in district-based elections, at the nuanced differences. Very different than what's happening at the National Party. I'll give you one final example, and then hopefully we'll get into one other point after this. Look, Democrats took back supermajorities in both houses of the state legislature, picked up three seats that were necessary in the Assembly, picked up just now one seat that was necessary in the Senate. Remember, California state Senate seats are larger than congressional seats, just to keep perspective. Yet there wasn't a single congressional seat that switched party hands in California. It's a distinction between a national party focus and effort as opposed to an on-the-ground focus and effort. Jim led the Republicans in the Assembly to take control of the Assembly in 1994. He didn't do it by treating the state as a monolith. He did it by looking at the nuanced differences state by state. When he took over as chair of the Republican Party, won back a handful of legislative seats that I had won before, and did it because he looked at the nuanced nature. The takeaway lesson is put a fat guy in charge of your elections and you're going to win. Jim and I both have that that record we can stand on. But the other is that coattails don't exist in California. They don't exist. And so the great example for that is Catherine Baker in the Bay Area. The only Republican in the state legislature and the Congress in the nine Bay Area counties. A district that overwhelmingly voted for Hillary and voted for her by comparable numbers against a credible Democratic challenger. So the voters are less singularly ideological than anybody would expect them to be. And for all of the callous ways of folks looking at political calculation, the reality is, especially in a district like that, where you have high information voters, having substantive, engaged elected officials that connect with voters is more determinative of an outcome than any of these other trends. Last thing, one of the other key distinctions, especially in the last several years, is that California's had two big reforms that were thought to be expansive on democracy. The one was taking redistricting away from the legislature and putting it in a special commission. Didn't love the idea, think it was poorly structured, but pretty well executed. And it would be interesting if you did that in other states, especially going into the next redistricting, if there's ever a chance for Democrats to take back control of the House in particular, you need a different approach to redistricting. But that was one. The second is that California was forced, really, through a budget vote to go to top two primary systems. And the argument was that it would increase choice. I always believed it would decrease choice and decrease voter participation, not increase it as the quote-unquote reformers suggested it would. The greatest example of evidence to support my point of view is looking at the United States Senate seat in California this year. You had two Democrats making their way to the general election, Kamala Harris, who won, and Congresswoman Loretta Sanchez, who lost, but only two Democrats. And you had a massive drop-off. So you always see a drop-off from the presidential race to down-ticket races. What's interesting in California is there were roughly 12.9 million votes cast for president. So you expect a little bit of a drop-off. There were only 11.2 million votes cast for the Senate. So a 1.7 million vote drop-off. That's pretty significant. Now, what tells you whether or not my assumption on top two is part of this is if you compare then not presidential versus Senate, but look at Senate versus any of our 17 ballot measures, even the most mundane ones. On average, 12.4 million votes cast on each of the ballot measures. So 1.2 million people voted on even the most mundane ballot measure and didn't vote for the United States Senate Senate competition between two Democrats. I think it reinforces the negative impact of the top two in terms of encouraging engagement. You can look at down-ticket races and see similar patterns, but the statewide numbers and the stark drop from ballot measures to something as significant as the first open Senate seat in 24 years really reinforces how significant that is. And the last reinforcement of the difference between the engagement is in 2010, horrible years for Democrats nationwide. Historically, in off-cycle presidential years, the party in power loses 5% of its seats in state legislatures across the country. In 2010, the number was double that. And the Assembly, under my leadership, was the only democratically controlled body in the country to not only reelect every incumbent, but to grow a seat with a Republican registration advantage. And people told me I was crazy to look at the seat because the Republican candidate was Andy Pugno, who had just successfully been associated with the passing Prop 8 in a district that overwhelmingly voted for Prop 8. And I had a candidate running against him who was a pediatrician. And everybody said, you know, horrible lineup, you're going to lose. But we won not by walking away from the distinction of the fact that Puno agreed with the majority of his constituents on Prop 8 and Dr. Pan disagreed with him, but in talking about everything else, in talking about economic and educational aspiration, and putting that distinction in context. And so by not walking away from the disagreement, but engaging voters in a substantive way about the day-to-day issues that mattered to them, we took a win that nobody ever saw. And so the lesson from California is not demographic. The lesson from California is a more nuanced, engaged engagement with voters on both issues and campaigns. Jim, now do you want to rebut?
Well, I'm curious now that you're eligible to get married. Has anybody agreed?
Again, the voters are smarter than that, and nobody has yet agreed.
By the way, John and I are longtime friends, as are Carla. We've never met, but I'm sure you and I will enjoy each other's company. Let me just make some general comments before I die. What did you say I was going to do?
Go the way of the wig.
Go the way of the wig. No, I don't think you were that polite. Let me just make some general comments. I'll try to be brief. I'm not a big believer in open-ended opening statements because we get way too long and then you don't get the questions you want. California is a fairly large state. There are more registered voters in California than there are residents in 46 of the other 49 states. So we are a fairly large political entity. I might want to disagree a little bit with John that we're not just demographic. We're a couple of things. We are demographic. We're a majority-minority state. There are more Latinos in California than there are non-Latino whites. In 2008, from January 1 until September 30th, and the reason I don't have updated data because that's when I stopped, I haven't had a chance to review it fully yet. From January 1 until September 30th in 2008, 66% of the people that registered to vote were non-Hispanic whites. By 2016, 8 years later, that 66 dropped to 57%, which is, you may say, only 9%, but that's 9% on a 4 million plus vote basis. I don't think there is one California. I think there are two Californias. If you're familiar with what's going on along the coast, it is a fundamentally different state than what's going on inland. And I'm not sure my good friends on the Democrat Party fully understand how bad it is in areas like the Central Valley and the Inland Empire, where my white trash neighbors and I live. We are a state that used to be reliably Democrat, but we tended to be more conservative when voters had a chance to weigh in on that. So we've had Democrat governors, Democrat elected officials. John mentions going back to 1883 to find Democrat supermajorities in both houses of the legislature until he very successfully led his party 4 years ago. You have to go back to 1882 to find Democrats winning every statewide office in a regularly scheduled gubernatorial election, except they've done it three out of the last four times. And Arnold, for those of you who paid a little bit more attention to his reelection, Arnold did not run for reelection as a Republican. He ran for reelection as an anti-tax Democrat. And I was part of a strategy team, and that was not an unconscious decision because 2006 was fairly horrible for our party across the country. But back to the idea of demographics, not just driving, we are now a liberal state. last month, we legalized marijuana. We extended a tax increase. We started a new tax. We banned plastic bags. We eliminated bilingual education for more intents and purposes. We passed, some kind of gun control, which may or may not have been necessary, given what our friend Kevin DeLeon did in the legislature. And just about, we made it easier to take away voters' right to pass bonds with Prop 53. And although John mentioned death penalty, we just barely saved the death penalty. So the idea that California used to be reliably Democrat in partisan offices, but was center-right in elections, I think those are gone. We are now a center-left state. I don't know how many of you are Star Trek fans. When I was recruited to leave the private private sector and take the job that pays me absolutely nothing as chairman of the party, I used to run around and say it may be the Kobayashi Maru. I don't know. Those of you who are not Star Trek fans, the Kobayashi Maru is a test where no matter what you do, everybody dies. We're a state in what I think is transition, which creates tremendous opportunities for the Democrats, who are really in functional control. And it creates opportunities for us. Y'all focus primarily on two races, a US Senate race and a presidential race. And Donald Trump lost by the last count close to 30 points in California. And by the way, that's on a scale that only has 100. So, that's not a bad, that's not a bad. On the other hand, his campaign did not do anything significantly in California, and the thousands of Trump phoners did over 1.2 million calls, most of them in targeted states, almost all of which Donald Trump won for president. But while you were focusing on the U.S. Senate race, where we had a top two, primarily because there were 12 Republican candidates in the primary who collectively managed to raise less than $1 million. We were focused on a lot of others. There were over 1,000 races in California that we were focused on. I believe in winning elections. And one of the reasons I think I was recruited to chair my party was to get them focused on smart things. I think when you pick fights you can't win, you can create the psychology of defeat. And that's not helpful for an organization, a business, or a political party. We managed to elect the right candidate, mayor, in San Diego a couple years ago, mayor in Fresno last month. There are more Republican county supervisors than there are Democrat county supervisors. 40% of the 40% of the women who are mayors and county supervisors happen to be Republican women. So our plan has been to rebuild from the ground up. And we didn't get in trouble over 30 years. We didn't get in trouble overnight. It took over 30 years, and we're not going to be out of trouble. A couple points you made I thought was interesting. When Pete Wilson ran for re-election as governor in 1994, 82% of the electorate was white. By the time Meg Whitman ran in 2010, that 82 dropped to 62. Dirty little secret is Meg got a higher percentage of the white vote of almost any Republican candidate in modern history, and she still lost by 13 points because the demographic changes were so great. Interestingly enough, 2 days after the election, I won't mention the forum because it's may have been a competitor to this. Park Skelton, the lead Democrat consultant for the Assembly Speaker, made two comments I found interesting. One, he said he thought they were going to pick up 5 to 6 Assembly seats. They may get 3, possibly 4, but I'm not sure. which is not out of the norm, with the exception of 2004. Republicans have lost seats in the assembly in every presidential election going back until Ronald Reagan's reelect in 1984. Were you alive, Hayward? Were you alive in 84? Ronald Reagan was an American president, Steve, just so you know. So that wasn't out of the ordinary. The most interesting thing Mr. Skelton said that I found fascinating was the most important victory they had was taking out Sherrill Brown, an African-American, pro-charter school Democrat who doesn't believe that poor Californians should have to spend 30 or 40 cents more a gallon for gasoline. And I found it instructive when the speaker's top political guy says the best win we had was taking out one of our own. I think that's instructive. So look, California is a state that all things being equal wants to vote Democrat. It's gonna be that way for a long time. It's been trending that way for a long time. And the Democrats now get to own it. And, you know, it'll be, I'm fascinated as to who they're going to blame when the economy cycles down and the mythology that we have a balanced budget exposes itself. For those of you who are not great at budgets, let me tell you, if you take enough items off your family budget, you can balance even your family budget. So California is going to be an interesting place to watch. I believe that if we ever get it right and can figure out how to message to these fastest growing communities, and let me tell you how fast they're going to grow. I hate sharing this, but someone will write it. I asked my demographers to tell me who the next decade of registrations are. So tell me who the 8 to 17-year-olds are in California. By and large, they're the people who are going to register to vote over the next decade. 52% are Latino. 52%. By the way, we get about 16 out of every 100 that register. 4% are African American. We get about 9. 11% are Asian. We get about 23. And by the way, the Democrats had a war on our Asian candidates this year. They took out Ling Ling Chang, they took out Young Kim, and they took out Eric Linder, who's actually Hispanic and Asian. But if we can ever figure out how to get it right, we will provide a roadmap for the country, because the rest of the country is looking a lot more like California. So, from your point of view, California might not have been a great election. From my point of view, it wasn't bad. We took control of the South Coast Air Quality Management District last year. May not be important to you, but I believe the only purpose in a political party is to take control of the government, to move your agenda for the betterment of the people in your city, state, county, or nation. We're electing pro-charter school people to county boards of education and local school districts. I can't take on the CTA in Sacramento with 25 or 28 members of the assembly out of 80 and 14 out of 40 members of the Senate, but I can elect pro-charter school people, and we can provide some kind of counterbalance to the government monopoly. I love intellectual dishonesty. We all have it. If you spend enough time with John and me, John will tell you my intellectual dishonesty. I'm fascinated by Democrats and Republicans, all of whom hate monopolies. The difference is my Democrat friends are willing to give monopolies to government, but they're not willing to do it to the private sector. So look, I think California is an interesting place. It's going to be fun to watch. If you look at just the top lines, you will miss what's going on in a lot of places, it will be fun. I'll probably be dead in 30 years, but it might be nice to come back here in 30 years and see if changes have been made. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions you have and try to go troll in DC and look for someone to marry John.
All right, thank you so much. I just want to throw out a few ideas. You know, I think the key question from all this is maybe demography is destiny. To what extent, you know, is the Trump election a blip? Is it a backlash? Or is ultimately the rest of the country, because of the demography we've just heard described, going to follow California? And in this interim period, if it is one, what role is California going to play in national politics? Is it going to be a model? Is it going to forge its own way? To what extent can it do that on things like climate change or healthcare or immigration? The sheer size of the state is just incredible. I mean, it's the, as Carla said, the fifth largest economy in the world. We've got 53 House seats, 40 million people, 55 electoral votes. On the other hand, in the rest of the country, they look at the left coast and they look at Silicon Valley and Hollywood and they think, you know, what does California have to tell us to laid off Rust Belt workers, to Walmart moms, and so forth. So how is California going to present an alternative vision for the country? To what extent can it? To what extent is Trump simply a, you know, a minor step backward or a blip in the arc of history? I would remind everybody that George W. Bush, another very inexperienced president, who committed a, one would think, fatal mistake in his first term, starting in the Iraq War, was elected to a second term. I wouldn't be surprised if we see a Trump second term. So with that, I'll open it up to questions. Yes, here in the front.
Thanks. I'm Peggy Orchowski. I'm the congressional correspondent for the Hispanic Outlook magazine. I've been here about 15 years, but 55-year resident of California, Santa Barbara, and Cal alum when we still had a journalism school, undergraduate. And spent a lot of time in South America, too. It was a real shock to come here 15 years ago and see how different people look at Latinos. There ain't no Chicanos here, for one thing. Never heard of them. And they don't know much about Asians either. Every time I go back to California, I'm just amazed. Santa Barbara, my hometown now, it's all Asian restaurants. You can hardly find a taco anywhere. And that's pretty much the population, too. I don't get you guys just sitting there. You talk about diversity. You don't see the diversity within the diversity. I mean, the Hispanics, I write about them. You know, they're Mormons, they're Asians, they're Jews, certainly a lot of Sephardics. There's no, just like an American identity, there's no Latino identity. It's not a race.
So do you have a question?
So please, you guys, I don't understand why you can't accept assimilation. One of the greatest stories of assimilation in America is a Hispanic population. I totally agree with you. It's not demographic, it's other stuff, and you've hit on some of it. So please, Mr. Kousser, maybe you should go back to your car.
I don't think any of us look at any of these communities as being monolithic. I think that there's shorthand that occurs in a conversation like this, and in any of our work, you dig deeper. And I'm sorry? No, I understand, but there's only so much detail you can go into in a 7-minute opening. I hate Jim being the chair of the Republican Party because he knows how to win elections. And one of the realities is he does.
By the way,
yeah, he does understand complexity and nuance within communities. That's why he's been successful at diversifying what the Republican elected official group in California looks like. Clearly, at the state level, he talked about some of those differences. But when you look at his focus on nonpartisan municipal office and local office, it has gotten much more nuanced and more diverse, significantly because of that understanding of nuance. And I would hope the same is true on the Democratic side.
And I think you're seeing, and the chairman mentioned this, that how the Republican Party is trying to change things from the ground up. And there are groups. Grow Elect is a group, a Latino group headed by a really strong guy named Ruben Barales, and they have worked at the ground level to rebuild the Republican Party and to elect folks at the school board level, at every municipal level, and they've gotten hundreds of wins behind them. Those kind of things are going under the radar in California, and I think that's where it's going to be interesting to watch, because at some point the voters there, we're looking at statewide elections where, as the speaker pointed out, Democrat versus Democrat for the foreseeable future. And maybe at some point voters are going to say, really, what, where's our choice here? And I think that's where it's going to be interesting to watch. When you have, you mentioned Catherine Baker, a very sharp and promising, I think somebody, a rising star. But the question is, under California's current system, as a Republican, where's she going to go? Because statewide office seems out of reach. The fact is, as was pointed out, that was an overwhelmingly Democratic district. There are going to be, I think, issues that propel Republican candidates, promising Republican candidates, and at the local level, when you talk about Latinos, there are groups out there, grassroots groups, that are making some significant inroads, I think, for the Republican Party in California. So it's not a...
If you want to come to a seminar for a deep dive, come to California. I'll introduce you to Dante Acosta, Ling Ling Chang, Young Kim, Stephen Choi, and a whole group of folks who, frankly, don't look like most of us on the panel. But we weren't invited to come to a deep dive on the dramatically different demographics and the subgroups with them. And if you really want to have an experience, come to the Central Valley and meet the Hmongs. Which is a group that I guarantee you none of us have figured out. I don't normally do panels because y'all have inherent biases, and I didn't want to leave something on the table. You referenced George W. Bush and Donald Trump, who lacked experience. Of course, George W. Bush had more experience than Barack Obama did when he was elected president. And I also want to point out, you know, for those of you who haven't figured out Donald Trump and why he's president, and if this doesn't apply to you, maybe forgive me, but you ought to look in the mirror. For the last 8 years, I've had the privilege of being called a racist because I voted for Mitt Romney and John McCain. Listened to MSNBC and CNN, and even occasionally a commentator on Fox News calling me a racist because I voted for the Republican nominee for president rather than the African American nominee for president who happened to be a Democrat. And by the way, when you all confuse racism with partisanship, you do two things. You diminish the horror of racism. And you signal people like me that maybe we should just be a little less vocal on our partisanship. And when Donald Trump's supporters get egged at rallies, as they did, by the way, in San Jose, and then the lovely mayor there decided to blame them rather than the thugs, who, by the way, may have been hired by the Clinton campaign. When Donald Trump supporters who have bumper stickers on their cars get their tires slashed, when Donald Trump supporters who have signs in their yards get their yards vandalized, it shouldn't surprise anybody that a significant component of Donald Trump supporters go underground and don't intend to share with you exactly what they were doing. I may be the only person on this panel that wasn't surprised that Donald Trump was elected president, because this economy sucks unless you live in the Silicon Valley or Orange County. You come to my neighborhood, we'd be real happy to have 9% unemployment in my county, and there are counties across the country like that. But I promise myself, it's why Ethan will tell you I don't like doing panels like this. But the inherent premise that George W. Bush lacked experience, but maybe Barack Obama did, is offensive to me and offensive to a number of people, many of whom voted for the next president of the United States.
John?
Look, George W. Bush also had more experience than John F. Kennedy. And I think it is important not to try to diminish that which different candidates bring to the table and not to try to satisfy ourselves by putting folks into boxes that don't often make sense. And the dynamic that Jim's talking about is a very real dynamic. And it's one that's not news to any of us from California, because this isn't the first time it's presented itself. When you look at Duke Majan's victory over Tom Bradley in Duke Majan's first election for governor, there's something that in California is called the Bradley effect. The underreporting of support for one candidate over another because of what other meta message may be delivered by people's interpretation of the support of George Duke Majan over Tom Bradley, who would have been the first African-American governor in California. It played itself out in 1994. If you compare the polling going into the election versus the results of the election, significant underreporting of support for Prop 187. If you look at even Prop 227 in 1998, if you look at Prop 8 in 2008, there's been this pattern when there are certain hot-button identity-based issues at play, the statistical predictive value of polling is diminished. This year, there was a question going in, if you looked at the difference between live polling versus electronic polling, whether you would see a delta, and whether that would give you any indication of fear of reporting. There wasn't much of one in the polling data, but there was still some concern that there would be an underreporting. And I think what many people have missed is that oftentimes folks are saying, the majority of the polls got it wrong, the LA Times Dorn's Life poll got it right. They didn't. The majority of the polls actually got it right to the extent that they were looking at what the overall national number was. Because from a popular vote perspective, one candidate won. From an electoral college perspective, a different candidate won. So the national polling actually got it right. The state polling had significant flaws and didn't predict the outcomes in specific states, and that's why you saw people being surprised by outcomes in the Rust Belt. But if you look at campaigns and how they're won, you cannot be surprised that a group of voters who are struggling to enjoy economic recovery didn't vote for a candidate they didn't feel was talking to them about their prospects for economic recovery. I'm not saying that I agree with their conclusion, but the campaign didn't speak to those voters in any way. So it wasn't this level of cognitive dissonance from the voters, the level of cognitive dissonance from those on the outside looking in. Now, with respect to the racialization, it's happened in both directions. And this campaign, in my opinion, has been one with more offensive dog whistle politics than any election in the last several decades, where folks who were intended to be the target of a comment knew that they were the target of a comment, and that other folks that needed to see the comment saw the comment, and then there was a half walk back multiple times. It has been an incredibly divisive and racialized environment. And there have been people victimized on both sides. And there has been a spike in reported hate incidents since the election. Now, the question really remains is how much of a spike has there been in incidents and how much of a spike has there been in reporting? And that's something that we need to do a deeper dive on, because sometimes the two happen at different rates. But I also want to just push back a little bit, Jim, on the assertion about Park Skelton. Park's not the speaker's consultant, his partner is. Park doesn't handle the campaign, Steve Barkin does. Park does his own races. And I agree with you that that is an offensive assertion that that would be viewed as the number one victory. I supported Sherrill Brown for re-election, even though ideologically I align. Yeah, even though ideologically I align more with the woman who beat her. And that wasn't the number one victory for Democrats. That may be the number one victory for Park ideologically. But it was part of a disturbing pattern that is made possible again because of these top two systems, where you conflate a whole bunch of things and find a well-heeled interest group to fund an attack that you wouldn't have in other circumstances.
Okay, I want to add something too. I've known you a long time, but I just want to challenge your assertion. The idea that the media, particularly in California, did not try to go to the Inland Empire or the Central Valley and cover those voters, I just have to dispute that. And I know personally, I was at the San Jose rally that you mentioned, and not because the Trump people gave me a media credential, because for months they denied my organization, Politico, from getting media credentials. And while I was covering that rally, I got a general admission pass and went inside. I was approached by the Trump people and told, we understand you're here to disrupt this rally. You're going to have to leave. I did not pay any attention to that, and I kept reporting as I did, but my fellow Politico reporter, Ben Schreckinger, was thrown out of that rally for committing journalism. So I think, I saw on both sides at that rally, yeah, there were people egged on the Trump side. I also saw a lot of get back behind the wall. So I think you mentioned this divisiveness, and particularly in California, you've got a tinderbox in many cases.
Yeah, and I don't think I brought a confluence between the two. My point was there are two Californias, and wherever you can see the ocean from a community, you're doing a lot better than what's happening in the Central Valley. That had nothing to do with Donald Trump, has nothing to do with anybody in California. There are two fundamentally different Californians. And that, I mean, David Valadao's in a 59% Latino district, and he managed to win overwhelmingly, but that's a Latino district that's in the heart of the Central Valley. My point wasn't about Trump. My point was there are two fundamentally different Californias.
And 26 counties
and that provides,
voted for Trump.
That
right?
provides, yeah. Irrespective of Trump, that provides opportunities, I think, because we're not a monolithic state. People want to look at California and suggest that we're a monolithic state, and we're really not. We're the Ozarks in some area.
I'd like to hear from Fab.
And I think one of the problems is those two areas are represented by different parties who don't have incentives to bring the rest of California along. Right, so when we had the Six States Initiative, which I thought was a terrible idea, but it would have been a healthy campaign for California to go through, to see that the Silicon State, so it was going to divide up the state six ways, Silicon State was going to be the richest state in the nation, Central Valley State was going to be the poorest state in the nation, lower per capita income than Alabama and Mississippi. Right, having that discussion and talking about why those areas don't feel like they're part of the California and feel like Sacramento is like the center in the Hunger Games, right, not representing them, that would be an important conversation to have, and it's different than when we were a north-south state with political parties' tentacles in both of those areas.
But I actually raised this east-west dichotomy before you did as well, because these are very different sets of realities. I disagree with you that they're represented by different groups of people. Increasingly, Democrats are winning seats that were not thought of as winnable in inland California, right? So 4 years ago, Senator Roth from Riverside, Jose Medina from Riverside, Cervantes in the Inland Empire, Rudy Salas getting elected by 66% in an overlap with David Valadao. So voters in the south end of the Central Valley saying, I'm going to send Democrat Rudy Salas to represent me in Sacramento, and I'm going to send Republican David Valadao to represent me in Washington, D.C., Susan Eggman in Stockton, Adam Gray in Merced, Arambola in Fresno. Steve Fox in the Antelope Valley. So there's at the federal level, yes. At the state level, more nuanced, which again speaks to the distinction between what's happening from a national perspective and from a DC-controlled perspective than what's happening on the ground. Let me go back and give Jim one more piece of credit. He talked about county boards of supervisors. San Diego County, traditionally thought of as a deep red conservative part of the state, is a red county in a blue state. Its largest city, San Diego, is now a blue city. So you've got a blue city in a red county, in a blue state, in a red country. None of that matters because what you're actually dealing with is individual voters in individual districts. As of this election, San Diego has gone back to a 100% Republican-controlled Board of Supervisors. All five seats. All five seats.
We won yesterday.
Right. All five seats are Republican. Right? So it is much more granular. It is much more granular. And the victories and the success going into the future have to be granular as well.
Any questions from the audience? Back there.
Hello. I'm Dale Doucette. I grew up in California. I went to school, college, graduate school. Was assistant city manager in two cities there. And I was aware that California, more than any other state, rather than conservative and liberal or Republican and Democrat, is issue-driven. And down at the level where I was, issues drove almost everything. I would like to hear the panel discuss what are the issues that California sees as important in the next 2 years, and what effect will their issues affect the rest of the country?
Thank you.
I think you have to talk about immigration when you talk about this.
Okay,
I think you have to talk about immigration when you talk about what happens in the Central Valley, what happens in the Salinas Valley if you're going to deport potentially millions of undocumented immigrants who support the economy of California, who are essential to the economy of California. I was at at UC Berkeley last week where there are an estimated, I think, 300,000 DACA students in California. They've already given up their family data. It's there, the government has it. Many of them are concerned now that their families are going to be deported based on what evidence or what criteria, a misdemeanor or traffic arrest or what, we still aren't clear. That the immigration impact has a huge potential impact on California, and that's where a lot of the angst is right now in our state. On campuses, out in the Central Valley, where a lot of these immigrant workers are, what happens to the economies in these areas?
Thad, I wanted to ask you, I mean, to what extent can California sort of lead the way out of Trump land, or will it, you know, sort of recede from that and become its own sort of political island?
Right, so when we have, my first class on California politics shows the map of California being an island, like the original cartographic mistake that gave rise to our name. And we've never corrected the name, right? Because we've always thought of ourselves as this island where the normal rules of politics don't apply. And really, in this last 20 years, we've become unhitched from the political tides that affect the nation, right? We went the same way with the nation in 1994, but in 2010, we zagged while the rest of the state zigged, the rest of the nation zigged. So there will be, to get to your specific question you threw out before, like, so can California actually lead on policy? So on the environment, California will develop clear sets of standards that like-minded states will follow, right? This happened in the latter years of the Bush administration, and then it was validated in the early years of the Obama administration, sort of setting different California standards, right? That will be clear, but it's gonna run into the limits of a Supreme Court that probably won't be as friendly to that kind of federalism. Immigration, California will take the most aggressive stance, and I think will create the policy model, right? The kind of ALEC version, right? That ALEC has done very successfully in creating policy models about how to, you know, what is the maximum way that you can do, the thing that you can do to stand up. Whether other states and cities will have the money to do that and take the financial hit is a big question, but California will be the test case for what's possible.
How about healthcare? I mean, all that money is coming from the federal government.
Right, 90%, you know, right. of the coverage of, well, so, I mean, California had a larger Medicaid system before it got the boost in Medicaid funding for Obamacare. So I think California will still have a fairly robust healthcare system for those in need, but not the kind of money to sustain premium subsidies or create the kind of our state version of Obamacare.
So well, I was the author of it. So I was the author of the Covered California. I was the author of the Medicaid expansion. You've got three populations. You've got the pre-eligible Medicaid population, you've got the Obamacare population, and then you've got the expanded Medicaid population, which goes up to roughly 130% of the poverty line. Those are three different questions. For the pre-existing population, I think, you know, barring Speaker Ryan completely reconstructing Medicare and Medicaid, that's a rather stable population. The expansion population is the next most stable. The least stable is the folks that are under covered California and the folks that are under Obamacare nationwide. California can't do it without a federal infrastructure. It doesn't work. The exchange was predicated on the federal framework being in place. But let's go to a couple of these other questions. On immigration, California's already set down the marker long before folks talked about a sanctuary, and it's nice for folks to tweet about it now and claim ground. We actually passed it as law. It was the Trust Act in California. The first version of it was vetoed by Governor Brown at the behest of then Homeland Security Secretary Napolitano. The second year, we got it passed. So these DACA kids absolutely have huge questions, but the questions aren't going to be revolved around whether or not there's a misdemeanor interaction or any of the like, because the Trust Act makes that relatively clear. I think the whole question about folks expressing themselves as sanctuary cities, you're right that it's not a consistent definition of what sanctuary is. And here's where I actually think the chancellor of the CSU system has the most nuanced and thoughtful conversation, because folks came to him and said, we would like you to declare the 23 CSU campuses across the state as sanctuaries. And he says, I can't, because one, there's not a general definition of what sanctuary is, and I don't have the authority to make some of the decisions that you would want and associate, so I don't want to give people a false sense of what a declaration would be, and instead had a thoughtful, nuanced discussion of what elements of control could be exerted by a campus. God forbid we actually have substantive, deep conversations instead of wanting to use a title like sanctuary city, sanctuary state, or the like. But California has the strongest expression. And interestingly, we passed that when I was there. We used Arizona's SB 1070 as part of the model of the defensibility of what we did, because the Supreme Court had invalidated certain elements, validated other elements, and specifically said that the state could act on a collective decision similarly to the way an individual law enforcement officer could act in an individual case. So we predicated our structure on that which the court had already held up as the enforceable elements of SB 1070. So I think there's some interesting things there. There was a very good piece in the LA Times yesterday by a professor at UC Davis Law School, and I can't remember the name right now, about the challenge, for example, on Prop 8. Prop 8 is still in the Constitution of the state of California. The president-elect has said it's settled law, but I don't know how you say that's settled law, but Roe versus Wade is not settled law. And if you change the composition of the court significantly, there's a very real likelihood that somebody could bring a new challenge. And if the court reversed itself on this question, then that would be an issue where Prop 8 would once again be in effect in California. So I think one of the things the legislature has to do is go through and look at places where the court has resolved issues, but the state hasn't reaffirmed the resolution. And I think that's going to be a significant amount of the work that the legislature will engage in this year. But the other question that the gentleman asked with respect to issues, it really does get back to the rest of the fundamental issues about economic growth and opportunity, and those two have to happen hand in hand.
Great, thank you so much. We're going to take a 10-minute break. Be back here at 2:25.